license officer, I can see you all. Welcome to the April meeting of the NSDAR William Bertram chapter. Okay, let's start with the ritual. Please stand.
Everybody, if you can.
Does anybody not have a book and need one of these?
Anybody?
To perpetuate the memory and the spirit of the men and the women who achieved American independence, to promote the development of an enlightened public opinion, and to foster patriotic citizenship, these are the objects of our society, daughters of the American Revolution.
Keep that which is committed to thy trust. Thou shalt remember all the way which thy God led thee, Deuteronomy 8:2.
Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord.
Our Heavenly Father, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank thee for thy guidance and for thy presence in the life of our country. We thank thee for all those yesterdays of our human race whose lessons and fulfillment have become a heritage to us. Continue, we pray, thy blessings upon this nation, that all who are a part of it may learn true nobility of manhood and womanhood. Grant us growth and understanding and increasing devotion to righteousness. In thy name we pray.
Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the American speak.
I believe in the United States of America as the government of the people, by the people, for the people, whose just powers are derived from the consent of the governed, a democracy and a republic, a sovereign nation of many sovereign states, a perfect union, one and inseparable, established upon those principles of freedom, equality, justice, and humanity, for which American patriots sacrificed their lives and fortunes. I therefore believe it is my duty to my country to love it, to support its constitution, to obey its laws, to respect its flag, and to defend it against all enemies.
The preamble to the Constitution of the United States of America.
We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, to ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
Please join me in singing the Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proud we
have emailed everyone that's on my list a copy of our last minutes. If you are not receiving it, just give me your name and your email address. Add it to my list.
Okay, and Carol White brings us the treasurer's report.
At the end of last month ago, this beginning of March, we had $1,527.44. And we then got an income of $38, and then had to do a replacement of name badges, which Barbie has since told me she found her. But we had some expenses. Treasurer General for Reed, our new member, Bob Lee for a presentation of the Battle of Kings of the Mountain, FSFDAR for badges, name badges, which are not here yet, and Treasurer General for a donation of $126.25, which leaves us $1,297.19 in treasury. There's a box up there for anybody who want to throw their change, a dollar bill or whatever, for scholarships. That's it.
Thank you. Okay, and the registrar's report with the Patriot Minute from Cherie Register.
Okie dokie, we ended up losing two members last year for non-payment of dues, but we are at 61. Lucy May is at National right now. Probably today will be, as a matter of fact, if I go on my computer, I'll probably see it right now being approved today. So that's the only one I've got. I've got another one that John and I have been working on that will be sent in shortly, hopefully. We're still waiting on one other one with it. So we're pretty good. So I'm 61. We've come a long way, ladies. A long way. Deborah can turn the camera off in my face. For y'all that do not know, I was doing community service in the cemetery, unearthing tombstones, and just, you know the phrase, caught the bear? Mm-hmm. Well, I caught the bear, and a tombstone called me.
Oh, yeah.
So, but everything's good. Okay, our Patriot Minute is Jonas Little. This is one of Linda's supplementals that has just come back in. Jonas Little served as a soldier in Colonel Branston's state militia from South Carolina, and he joined after the fall of Charleston. He lived in the 96th District in Union County, South Carolina. He was born around 1755 and died approximately April 2nd, 1821. And in doing Lucy May's paperwork, I honestly believe that Jonas Little fought under Lucy May's Patriot. They were in the same area, same battles.
Wow.
So it's just, you know, a small world to be with that. So I'm going to give this to you, Linda, to add to your little collection.
All right, thank you.
And we also have another one of Linda's supplementals that we ended up with an error message on, so we'll be taking care of that. That came in last week, but my brain wasn't focusing on that.
Okie dokie, thank you. Committee reports. The Christmas Tree Project by Suzanne Moulding. She could use some help.
Yeah, have you got something? I made a couple phone calls, and I just want to get a general consensus from everybody that we can do the clay one, but we can also do the Putnam County tree at the Bex. So I need to kind of show of hands. Do you want to put your money in Clay County or Putnam County?
Putnam County.
That's what I kind of thought. So anyways, their information is online from last year. It's pretty cut and dry. Their trees are like $50 to $150. They raffle their trees. So anything we put on it is probably not coming back to us. So then I just got a donation already of some stuff. I know it's early, but Christmas in July is soon. So that's where we're at.
Will you let us know some dates, like for getting together to do ornaments or?
Yeah, but I think it's like in October when they put their application out, so
we should be done.
Anybody wants to bring something?
What kind of decorations are you?
Well, since it's going to be indoors, since we're doing that one.
Yeah.
Anything we do, it's not going to come back to you.
Do you want just plastic or kind of stuff that you want by the county to do?
Patriotic.
Stuff in the back, this is a little narrow in here. Stuff.
What we did one year, we did the, maybe it's kind of like what you made, Mary, at one time, the little patriots, picture with the revolutionary hat, that, you know what I'm talking about?
The silhouettes you're talking
yeah.
about.
Yeah, and did that, and then put your patriot's name on it, so
just,
that was.
About that. Yeah, you know, something like that. We just have to get somebody volunteer to do the little cricket, was it a cricket?
Amy said she would do the silhouettes.
So we could get everyone's patriot's name on one of these jobs. Anyways, working on it. And in Bex in their showing where all the cards are.
Okay, thank you. Service to America hours, monthly reports. How many are reporting any hours that they do or any moments that they do for DAR?
Well, I am.
Sheree should be lifting her hand. She puts in about 18 hours a day.
I can check to see who's putting them in.
Okay.
I don't want to shame nobody.
Yeah. Well, if we have to do, I'm not above publicly embarrassing people.
Well, I know there's a lot of people out there. I saw somebody picking up trash on the road the other day in the newspaper.
Absolutely you can.
Anything you do, ladies, just think about.
Can we get the link posted to the Facebook group?
Now, one thing, it's like bagging, collecting the grocery bags. I know some of the Placa Woman's Club collects grocery bags, and we collect grocery bags in Crescent City Woman's Club. Now, just for collecting your own trash, basically, you can't count that in hours. But, like me and John, I imagine you're involved in the Placa one too, if they're collecting thousands of grocery bags, and they're sitting there and double bagging them, and folding them, and then taking them down there, those are already count. If you count it out of Woman's Club, you can still count it through DAR. So you can double your hours all over the place. So, you know, just dealing with your own trash is one thing. But when you're doing an amount of you know, service by picking up all that kind of stuff, it's tons. But you know, anything you do, just think about it. I was the world's worst last year about doing hours. But once you get into the habit of doing it,
yeah,
and get into the system, and you get the first group of them in there, all you got to do is hit duplicate and change your hours. It's the same thing over and over and over again. So it's pretty simple.
When did that do that?
By the end of the year. Yeah, about whole year. And the chapter is assigned so many hours that we're supposed to have done.
So how does it benefit the chapter?
It's part of the hours that's part of national in their accounts. But everything you belong to, church, you know, anything, all goes together.
Even if you think you're just helping family, I keep telling Heather, when she goes to the doctor with me, she can count that.
So, there's just all kinds of different ways. Like I said, I was the worst. This year I decided I would try to be better, although I still did not count the hours I spent on genealogy research. I don't do that. But all my other stuff, like dating in the cemetery, I you can do it for the newsletter?
Yes.
The hours y'all spend in genealogy society, the what y'all did at the fair, all those hours count. Anytime you do stuff for interarchy,
yes.
Anything you basically do.
Anything that benefits the county and the community.
Yeah.
Anything. Okay.
I know a lot of people don't want to brag about what they do. I've heard that several times.
Yeah.
But get that out of line.
It's not really going to be
hard. No, just keep your touch.
Celebrate 250 discussion. Okay, who's got? Did you want to say something?
Yeah. I keep forgetting about, my husband and I go the second Wednesday of every month go to the VA and give out 24 donuts and 24 bottles of water. And I keep forgetting that
counts.
We've run out of money, so it's coming out of our we've been paying all just the water. That's that, you know. But then several of you had added to it for the donuts, and I think it's been 3 months now that we've been doing it ourselves. But we love doing it, and so if anybody wants to. Add to it, or if you want somebody else to at least give the money, whatever, because I leave it at a different place than my billfold for sure. But at any rate, my husband was in the Marine band during, what was it that nobody wanted to call a war?
Vietnam.
Yeah. At any rate, he was there for 4 years in the Marine Corps band. He played a saxophone and clarinet for two different presidents and for Queen Elizabeth. So I'm pretty proud of him myself. I didn't know him back then, but I'm proud of him. And he helps me. He helps me in a lot of ways because I have chemo brain and I don't remember diddly squat anymore. But my husband is very veteran-y, and so he goes with me and helps me to do our business, and we will do it as long as both of us can get to it. And every month, the second Wednesday, everybody can come with us if you'd like. We have to call ahead of time to make sure that either Winn-Dixie or Publix in Palatka can have the right, have some donuts, but we have to know that a day ahead of time.
Thank you, Rusty.
Sally.
Anybody that wants to donate to the cause,
Could we pass a little basket or something around, the hat around, to just drop in a dollar or two, whatever you...
Well, we don't have a basket to use.
I can find something in the kitchen.
Okay, while Nancy is looking for something for the veterans donations, let's move on to the celebration, the 250 discussion. Celebrate 250. It's been suggested that we change the name of our Constitution Day celebration to Celebrate 250. And I think that's a pretty good idea. And it's going to be on Saturday, September 15th, because the 17th comes on Monday this year. And we can't ask people to take off work for that. So, do we need to vote for that?
We haven't decided that.
Saturday.
So what we need
Sunday
to do,
that's always
yes,
Saturday 14th.
Oh, it is? I should have looked at my calendar. Okay, well, it's going to be on the weekend.
So what we need to decide as a chapter is if that's the way we want to go. If we do, we can apply for a $500 grant to help us with the renting of the church and everything, if the church is still friendly with us. Uh-huh.
Any discussion? Does anybody have any opinions on that? I'm going to have to assume that if everybody's silent, you were in agreement.
Okay. This is September the 15th?
14th.
14th. 14th.
We'd like the offering.
Nancy's found a container, so if you want to donate to help Cindy or Rusty and her husband with the money and the water and the donuts for the vets over at the VA.
They've been doing the local this for VA. Such a long time and doing such a good job.
Okay, next up, Bertram Frolic. Cindy is the chair of that committee.
Okay. So this is April 27th, and it's as much like what Sally has already talked about, where there's going to be a tent and we'll have water there for the participants who work with us. And then, you know, we're going to, we dress up in our outfits, you know, from the Revolutionary War outfit, or we wear our DAR outfits. And we're just going to walk around the park, and hopefully we'll have, I think we'll have brochures and, to pass out to talk to people about the DAR, you know, and give them some information about the DAR as we do that. And that's the idea about it, is to bring DAR, like a DAR awareness kind of thing, and hopefully to bring in new membership, right? So, and then we're going to, I do have a sign-up sheet going around, and if you can help, I really would appreciate you joining us and helping us out. That would be really wonderful. And this is the sign-up sheet. I'll go ahead and continue it. And just put your name on it and let me know, so I'll put it over here. So, Minnie, I think that's it. Minnie, questions?
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Freedom Fest Committee. Vicki Dennis is chair of that, but because of her work schedule, she can't be here. So, Chrissy's been talking to the police.
Oh, I am?
Yeah. That's what I'm told.
Okay. Yeah, our church is part of the people that organize it. We don't receive any benefit financially from the Vets Freedom Fest, but we want to honor all of our veterans. We invite all of the public, especially the veterans. They get a free meal. They have booths set up to present benefits for the veterans, like housing and, you know, insurance, just whatever. We try to get as many groups to come as we can. And it's always falls on the same day as the Frolic, and it falls on the same day as the Blueberry Festival. So just spread the word for us. Help us get anybody that's not already committed to something else to come.
Okay, thank you. Don't forget your ink cartridges. And Cherie's going to talk to us about the bylaws quickly.
Quickly. And one of the classes I was taking, y'all, they made you start looking at your bylaws. And when I started looking at our bylaws, it was like, oh my gosh, we are way out of date. Way out of date. So I got hold of Sally, and we appointed kind of a committee of Deborah, Christy, Mary, Nancy was on there, Carol, Cindy, Suzanne, Julie, and I sent out what y'all got the other day from Christy, where you've got the copy of the bylaws. It's got our old bylaws on one side with the corrections on this side. And I wanted to go ahead and do it that way because we got to vote on them next month. So I wanted to be able to have the summer to print out the new bylaws along with the new yearbook. So that's kind of how that all kind of evolved into one thing. So, yes, ma'am.
My compliments to whoever did the formatting, because it's such an easy way to compare the two and to see what the updates are. it's the best presentation for that that I've seen.
Well, thank you, ma'am. Yeah, because the only one that was really out of whack was the electronic one. Mm-hmm. I put that where it needed to be because it was really throwing everything out. But I did get a lot of corrections and input back in from the people that we originally sent it out to. So does anybody else have anything that they can think of that would go along with it? Or we need to change?
That's great. Thank you so much for all
so
this.
So if not, we will vote on it next month to make sure. So,
okay. Quickly here. The Memorial Day Parade will meet same place, always, same time. We're still looking for someone that's got a little trailer that we can have, like a little float that we can decorate so that more people can show up, because there's so few of us that can walk 11 blocks. Scholarships will be, a scholarship will be presented next month, so we need money for the scholarship. There's a scholarship box on the counter. Flag Day, put this on.
Does anyone have a son, daughter, grandson, or granddaughter who's graduating this year?
Does anybody have a graduating senior? Does anybody have a graduating senior in your family?
No. I have a granddaughter graduating in December.
Say that again.
James Madison University in Virginia.
We need to do high school.
Is this, yeah, the scholarship for the high school students.
You do?
Not this year, next year.
Next year, okay.
Okay. Anyway, put this on your calendar. June 14th at 11 a.m., we're having our Flag Day luncheon at Muscle White's. The other two festivals that were not mentioned is the Blueberry Festival and the Catfish Festival. We're not doing a formal presentation. Just show up in your uniforms and talk to people. Walk around, let them see us. We just want to be visual. We want them to know that we exist.
I will put out here our flyers at the Catfish Festival Saturday.
Okay.
I'll be at the historical booth, so
I'll put those out. Oh, so okay. Member recognition, Sheree, you're up.
Very nice.
With this class that I'm taking, which I need to quit taking, it keeps creating things that I've been in this organization for 43 years and have never really paid attention to everything. There is so much out there that we need to recognize people with. And one of them is a past region of ours, and I need to have the membership's approval to make Miss Nancy Preston an honorary past regent.
She was regent for 6 years.
She's the one that built this group up from just a handful of people.
That is very true. From that handful that I was part of, that we were existing, and then Nancy brought us back to life. So that is one thing that I would like us to vote as a membership to do.
We have to make a motion.
We have to make a motion from the group. It has to be in the minutes.
I want to make the motion. To vote Nancy Preston honorary regent for the William Bertram chapter.
And we had our state regent, Cindy, help us
get
it together. She and Janet and some members that have been members of in the state for quite a while, because I knew nothing when I took over. I mean, I was told somebody's got to be regent, and Donna O'Hara and Lorraine pointed to me, and I said, yeah. Y'all, I haven't been in DAR very long. And
we existed many years when we should have disbanded.
because we weren't legal the way we were doing things. So.
Thank you. Now,
but thank you very much.
We're going to adjourn the meeting and.
We have the motion, we had the second. We need the vote. All in favor.
All in favor.
Aye.
Any opposed? Don't you dare. Okay. Okay, now we're going to adjourn and Mary's going to introduce our guest speaker. Okay.
Mary, is it okay if I give this to
Rusty?
To Rusty.
We just give it to her. And she keeps it separate.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. So if anybody else wants to donate, we came up with $78.
So I have the privilege now to introduce our program speaker. You're probably thinking, where the heck did we find this guy? I met Cowan at the Bronson Mulholland House when the Historical Society had a man come in to speak about the Seminole War. And he had come, Cowan had come to listen to him and listen to his presentation and to learn about Palatka and how that all fit together. I asked him to write a little bio. And I'm just going to pull a few things out of it. underneath the smile and interesting look, Cowan is an educator. He's been a teacher for 12 years in the school system. He taught grades 6 through 12 all across the country. From Orlando with the Orange County Public Schools, he taught history for 3 years in an alternative program and 2 years in a regular public school program. He has a passion for education. Cowan has been a teacher in downtown high school in San Francisco, California, where he taught his students publishing as well as acting. In Oakland, he taught psychology and earth science to seniors in an all-Asian population. But California is really expensive to live, so back he came to the East Coast. In Maryland, Cowan taught for 3 more years in Prince George County, Anne Arundel County, and ultimate assignment the Baltimore City Public Schools. He's the father of 2 precious little girls, Eltha Marie and Aruba Adora. I can't say their last name. What brought Cowan back to Palatka? This was his version of a midlife crisis because at 38 years old, divorce. But he has not let that slow him down. Since being in Palatka, he started 2 companies, one a publishing company that produces the Dancing Mastodon magazine, it's lovely, and the other a beverage company, the Earth Given Juices, and it is delicious. It's made from red sorrel. It's really good. It's a kind of health juice that adds to their diet. Since Cowan's been here, he's been researching his family in Palatka, who settled here in the 1800s, and he has found part of his family, the Black Seminoles. So it is fitting to bring him to discuss his original question, who are the Black Seminoles, or as he calls them, the Florida Maroons. Now my mother's old enough she went to Palatka High School when they were the Palatka Maroons.
Yes.
And we've tried to get that connection there. So let's welcome Cowan to our chat.
Thank you very much. It is a honor and privilege to be among you. And thank you for adopting me. I'm gonna head over there and set up the presentation. I don't have a projector, and I would like that so that everyone will be able to see, so I'll have to just speak loudly and just give me, Carrie Hicks, just like James Winroe, Teddy Roosevelt.
Lisa, you have a chair?
Sorry, I had a dentist appointment. I'm late.
No worries.
So I guess he eat his food too?
Because he left it.
We can picture your own food.
Do you need food? Do you need food? We can get you food.
Okie doke. All right, so I don't have a projector, but I'll try to not talk you to death.
We tried to broke it.
Okay.
He just hit six.
Inappropriate to discuss Afro Seminoles or Florida Maroons and the history of Florida at the point of the Civil Wars. Any attempt to discuss the details of the Seminole Wars without including the role of the Florida Maroon, along with the runaway slaves, should be seen as propaganda. No different from the Warner Brothers Hollywood film of the Seminole War, if any of you recall, 1951, Distant Drums, directed by Raoul Walsh, starring Rock Hudson, Barbara Hell, and Anthony Quinn. Much of the film was shot in the Everglades National Park, and Wildcat was depicted, but it was a historical. A truthful history allows readers and viewers to determine what perspectives they will consider and believe, and determine how they will act on what they believe. But you must give them all the sides to accurately decide. The choice should be that of the reader and not the paper. Why? Not only in the 1800s, nearly 300 years, not only is the 1800s nearly 300 years after the initial contact between Aboriginals, Europeans, and Africans, but the Seminole War itself is a defining moment for the change that is already occurring in American history, which is the Native removal west of the Mississippi River. So the Seminole War is a part of that. It's not the same. All right, if I am to determine the Afro-Seminole, then I have to give you the background of the Afro-Seminole and his environment as it relates to the relationship between the African and the Native amid the colonization of this continent. The establishment of the Spanish, the French, the Dutch, and the English colonies were being forged on the land previously owned by the Aboriginals, or the natives of the land. So I will refrain from using terms like Indian or Native American so that we can clearly cut through the historical fallacies which impose confusing terms or sometimes motives that we may not be aware of. Okay. Did I get to this?
No. We're getting there.
All right. In order to explain the Afro-Nativist perspective, it is also important to identify important identities. For example, white Americans. Why did I choose that? At this junction, we'll see how it gels. The white American did not exist in the British colonies. Follow me.
The British.
These colonial subjects considered themselves British subjects. Subjects of the crown and King George II or III. So white identity is not created at Plymouth Rock or Jamestown. Until the American Revolution, where whiteness becomes forged by a bloody struggle between the colonists and their British rulers. But not only that, also the native people who are displaced from their ancestral lands, and those natives are fighting a unsuccessful genocidal war against the invaders of their land. And as an added struggle, the colonists have brought in an entirely new group of people. Africans and poor Europeans are Slavs to build their country. So the British colonists are stuck between fierce natives who want to kill and scalp them, Africans and poor Slavs who want their freedom and humanity but are crushed by a labor system, and given the chance, they would cut their master's throat in revolt, and their British rulers from the mother country who sponsored their colonial companies and they expect to be paid back handsome. So they are taxing. So these British colonists forge a completely new identity through struggle, blood, sweat, tears, murder, being murdered, starvation, war, disease, exploration, Christianity, the idea of converting savages to Christ, capitalism, and the creation of bohemian economies. Being successful in that gargantuan struggle is what creates the white identity. And on the opposite end of that spectrum creates the black identity. To a large extent, they actually create each other. In the original plan, the black identity is not on the receiving end of the benefits of this struggle. Because someone has to build the country and label to ensure it is maintained. The native, though human, is not human. Their identity is savage. They are savages in need of civilization, in need of Christ. They don't deserve the land. This is the promised land for Christian Americans. The term American is very important. It identifies who owns the credit. The Roman Catholics, the kings of England, Spain, France, the Dutch Netherlands, and those are the people who made the rules. It is in this atmosphere where the white American is creating their identity that the natives and the Africans meet. This is my theory based on Herman Melville's 1851 classic, Moby Dick, which is the first time whiteness is identified as a identity. And being that it was written in 1851, Herman Melville was trying to kind of be prophetic, I guess.
That can be intoxicating and dangerous. Chasing whiteness in a boat that's representing the nation. You have Captain Ahab representing the president, the father of the nation, and a white whale representing whiteness. All this is hard to cover in 30 minutes, so let's try. I think I'm already done with 30 minutes. there are lots of interchanging parts, Spanish colonies, English colonies, French colonies. To explain the Afro-Native perspective would be inappropriate without all of those. So, I should have brought some slides. Here's a picture of Chief Meganope.
We can see.
Yeah, I broke my own thing. Alright, so there's a photo of Chief Meganope here. And I actually wanted to give you guys an article that was recently published in the Florida Today in Jacksonville. And it was basically, I'll just give you a short synopsis to run through, because I know, how much time do I have?
About 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay, so let me speed, let's do the speed. Yes. We have a woman who makes a plea from the Seminoles in Oklahoma. After the Seminole War, these black Seminoles that refused to stop fighting, they were sent west with the group, the native Seminoles. They were all sent to the Indian Territory. During the Trail of Tears. Mm-hmm. So you have a group of Florida Maroons who also journeyed with them. However, in the Indian Territory, essentially because the Black Seminoles had a policy, they were essentially the descendants of the Spanish trained colonial militia. These Florida Maroons. So when they had gone to the Indian Territory, they essentially were kind of like given asylum to any of the slaves from the other Indian nations that ran into their camp. So that led them into a conflict with the other Indian nations, because they were the slaves of the other Indian nations were running to their camp. And they were giving them asylum. So the Black Seminoles in Oklahoma actually decided that they would go to Mexico. And they journeyed to Mexico. Unfortunately, during their journey, they actually got into it with the Apache and the Comanche. The Comanche had never encountered blacks before, and essentially they kind of thought that maybe they were rolling with the U.S. Army. So there was a situation where the Comanche had kidnapped two of the Black Seminoles' little girls, and they were told that they peeled their skin. So as a group, it kind of set that group of Black Seminoles, who were led by a chief named John Horse and Wildcat, who was depicted in the Hollywood film, So it left them actually with a kind of a blood spat with the Apache and the Comanche. Once they got over to Mexico, they were given land right at Eagles Pass, and they were essentially kind of get, they had a pact with Mexico that if they patrolled and protected the border of Mexico, because the Apache and the Comanche would raid Mexico as well, if they just protected the border, that after a couple of years that the Mexican government would actually grant them a, give them a land grant, which they did. But some of the Black Seminoles wanted to return back to the United States. So they actually decided that they would go to Texas. The US Army was trying to get the Apache and Comanche out of Texas. So essentially the Black Seminoles would join in that same fight to kind of act as the scouts and the cowboys. It's kind of where you get the story of the Buffalo Soldier, but most people don't know that those soldiers were Black Seminoles that were seeking out the Apache and the Comanche and helping the U.S. Army get rid of the natives to free Texas, or to free up Texas for settlement. But they were promised by the U.S. Army some land in exchange, another land grant. Those Black Seminoles in Texas never got their land grant. So, essentially you have a group of Black Seminoles who are in Texas today, you have a group of Black Seminoles who are in Mexico today, and you have a group of Black Seminoles, some of them did make it back to the Indian Territory, and they are not actually a part of, they're not officially a part of the tribe, and they don't receive any of the benefits of the tribe. So in this article, you have a young lady who is a Black Seminole who's actually requesting to come back to Florida, which is heartbreaking because most of the Black Seminoles in Florida, the ones that weren't sent back were sold into slavery. So they won't remember them. Their families probably, you know, have no history of what happened. So the article in itself kind of gives you an idea of what the Black Seminoles are facing. I'm gonna skip forward. I think I was gonna make this longer, but I'm gonna skip this.
Cowan, while you're doing that, do I remember right that your grandmother was born on the reservation in Fort Pierce?
Yes. So my grandma was born on the reservation in Fort Pierce. And that's when the story kind of gets like, oh, whoa, whoa. Because what I was taught in history were most of the Blacks who came to Florida came from the Gullah Geechee, which is another mixture of natives and Africans. But for the ones, for the Africans who were here during the Spanish colonial period, those folks would have, you know, been here with the Seminoles, and they would they were like magnets to the reservation. So it was interesting finding out my own connection to them, and then how far, I'm still researching how far it goes back. And ironically, it's the names, the surnames that you find. I found the Butts, the last name Butts is in my family. The last name Sneed is in my family. The last name Lewis is in my family, and those are known Black Seminole families in Florida. So
they have Anglo-Saxon names, but not Indian names?
No. Well, yes. 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 And yes. There were three Florida Maroon colonies. We've heard of the Fort Moses colony that was established in 1734, but they disbanded once the British took over. There was also the Florida Maroon colony at Prospect Bluff. It looked like it didn't save my information, but Prospect Bluff was created during the War of 1812. Essentially, you had a group of British Marine generals, admirals, who had decided that they would arm the Africans against the Americans in the War of 1812. So they set up a fort along the Apalachicola River at Prospect Bluff. And essentially they were led by a man named Garcon, who was a free colonial militia Marine. And the story goes, essentially, Andrew Jackson, on his first trip into Florida that began the Seminole War, Andrew Jackson had sent his, I believe it was Colonel Daniel Clinch, to remove the Seminole Fort. They call it the Negro Fort, but it was also called Prospect Bluff. And once the ships had come across Prospect Bluff, a gunfight began, and Colonel Clinch, actually, their ship shot a hot rod into a artillery magazine, and it essentially exploded the entire fort. From the reports of it, it seemed like the military operation became a rescue mission, as they said in the report. Once they got out of their ship, you know, they were expecting a fight, but they saw body parts everywhere. They saw people at the top of the trees, so it became a rescue mission. The Creek Indians that were along with the regiment, Andrew Jackson, they essentially they took Garcon and the Chickasaw chief, and they executed them.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, we're gonna have to leave. She has to pick up a granddaughter and take to the land, so
my husband and I just listened to this on history.com.
Yeah,
just
Bluff.
2 days ago. Yeah, about Prospect Bluff. Yeah. And they said that when they shot that hot cannonball into the fort, that the explosion was heard 100 miles away.
Wow.
It was such an explosion.
Oh, wow.
Right. And the refugees who left, that you will have a number of Creek refugees who were also there with the Negroes who had been trained by the British to fight the Americans. They will actually move further into Florida, essentially along the Suwannee River, and under Chief Bowlegs, and that's going to attract Andrew Jackson into Florida to kind of to pursue those refugees. The third Florida Maroon colony is exactly where the refugees went. From Prospect Bluff, the free runaway slaves, they ran, and the Creeks, they actually ran all the way to a place called Angola. Angola was a colony that is in today Bradenton. The Bradenton family moved down and purchased the land that that Angola was on. But Angola was a Florida Maroon colony of about 750 people to about 1,000 people. And it was well known during that era because all the people from Prospect Bluff went there. Andrew Jackson had heard of it. And essentially, I believe it was a number of generations. It wasn't a colony in the sense that it was financed by a company and it had a group of people assigned. It was a colony that it was in the sense of people, refugees accumulated there over time, and they were capable human beings of building a settlement. So when Andrew Jackson actually was territorial governor of Florida in 1821, he had the Marines actually seek out Angola and destroy it because he said its existence would threaten the entire territory. So many of the people from the Angola territory, including Chief Osceola. Osceola, he actually was a refugee of the Creek Wars, along with his uncle, Manawa, who is also called Peter McQueen. They actually were refugees who lived in Angola at the time. And so Chief Osceola, he's not a paramount chief in the Seminole tribe. He would be seen as a regular chief, but he's a Creek that was a refugee at the Angola colony.
They name so many places for him. He's the most prominent one that people in Florida know of.
Yeah, he's one of the famous ones, but he wasn't like, as far as standing and status in the Seminole group, he was more of a, he was someone who was adopted into the Seminole tribe.
In Ocala, Amy and I and another friend on Saturday went to Fort King in Ocala, and that's been restored. It's now a park you can go in. They have films about the Seminole Wars and things. And Osceola was arrested there at that fort. So we have that right, you know, almost locally.
It's all here. There was a, along that note of locally, there was a famous Florida Maroon named Abraham who had founded the town of Picolata.
Picolata.
Which is, I won't pronounce it right.
It's Picolata.
And essentially, I have kind of been like, is Picolata Palaka? Is it?
No.
It's one of those.
Got its name changed from Piccolo into Palaka because it was too close to
Piccolo. Now that makes sense. So the founder of that that city, which was close to Okahumpee, which is that close to that little substation, if you're taking I-75 off of after you pass Wildwood going to Orlando, close to that area, which would have been where Micanopy's chief, his town would have been. Micanopy would have been considered a king of the Seminole tribe. And then you have John Horse, who is also another well-known Florida Maroon, who actually is one of their leaders when they go out west. So, yeah. And I had essentially had a slide of different Muskogee Paramount chiefs. The term Seminole is widely used. It's a Spanish term, but the end of them would be, or the name that we would have called ourselves would have been Muskogee. It's a Creek, one of the branches of the Creek tribe. And then, of course, you have the notable officers of the Seminole War. I believe the DAR has a marker for Daniel Noonan, who I actually think that his invasion into Florida is the beginning of the Seminole War, where he actually comes into Florida after the British take are said to have control of Florida, and Daniel Noonan, he takes over St. Augustine's fort, if I'm not mistaken, and then travels into Alachua to confront or to capture slaves, and he actually encounters King Payne, the person who the area is named after, Payne's Prairie. And they have a huge battle where King Payne is murdered in that skirmish. But in my point of view, I think Daniel Noonan is kind of his invasion is the start of the Seminole War.
What was the date of that, his invasion?
His invasion, I believe, is in 1812. So around the same time that the War of 1812, just a little bit before. Then you have General Edwin Gaines, who Gainesville is named after. He pursues the Black Seminoles. You have General Thomas Jessup. Jessup actually said this is a Negro, not Indian war. That was a quote directly from Jessup. This is a Negro, not Indian war. General Abraham Hustis. So kind of bringing to light those towns that we drive by. It's like, oh, yeah. That's the guy. Then of course you have General Andrew Jackson, Zachary Taylor. I believe the Seminole War kind of, if you were a military man, it was kind of that war that made you notable in the military. General Winfield Scott, he ran for president but didn't win. And you have a Colonel William J. Worth, who actually ended he was the colonel that took over not for Zachariah Taylor, but for the general after Zachariah Taylor, and ended the war.
Thank you, Cowan. Are there any questions
I should have chopped it up a lot better.
You did wonderful.
I have a couple of books on the first and the second Seminole War. Are they the ones that have been written lately? Are they more in line with what you're talking about, rather than
how lately have you
Frank Walmer?
I don't at the moment. Forgive me, but I'm doing my family genealogy, trying to write a story about it, so I've got all kinds of names in my head. But no, because I wanted to find out more about what happened in this particular area. They're not orderly yet, so.
Sure.
There are no books, but I don't know
I think this book, Black Seminoles by Kenneth Porter, is a excellent, it kind of puts you right there, like, that's where I got the quote from Thomas Jessup. I was like, it kind of like puts, gives you the front row seat at the war. So there's another one, I believe it's the Maroons at Prospect Bluff. The Maroons at Prospect Bluff is a great one. I wondered about that, and from the founding of Palatka High, they would have known, or the people who built the school would have known.
Possibly, but it was never made into a story about it.
So, yes?
Now, what language do they speak?
If I'm not mistaken, it's a Muscogee dialect.
From the Spanish, the Indian, the African,
a mixture of the native and the African language. So, in reading Black Seminoles, it was said that the natives that are currently in Mexico still speak a dialect of the Afro-Seminole language mixed with Spanish. So it's still around. But as far as the folks who are still here, we're English bound.
Well, sure. Yeah.
So,
wow.
Yeah, one question.
Hi. I'm just wondering if everybody here realizes that we are related to each other. We are, every person on this planet is related to each other. So you're stuck with me, honey. I'm your cousin and you're stuck with me.
That, I was looking up some butts and I was looking up in Sneed, the town manager is a Connie Butt. And I look at her, she's this white woman. And I'm like, I wonder if she knows.
You're stuck.
So, sorry to take up so much of your time. Next time, I'll make sure to laugh more.